the behaviour of some of our young people that we're making in Wales today isn't what it could be. That's the leadership side. Let's look at the rugby side. We'll just say Georgia, we'll park it there and we'll move on. Wedyn, drychwch ar pwy sy'n gyda ni. Look at who we've got today to bring these two worlds together. This is the man that led the whole of the Welsh Government, no pressure, for 9 years. This is also the man that Thomas used the word sports analyst. Can I miss my great Twitter handle? His Twitter handle admits to that. So look at the chance that we've got to bring all of this together today. I think it really is perfect timing. It's a perfect storm, as it were. So, without further ado, Karen Jones. Beth yw leadership?
Well, diolch Rebecca, bore da bawb, diolch am ddod gyda llaw heddi. Warm welcome to you all, and the first question you're going to ask is, what is he doing here? What does he know about rugby? For a start, he's a politician. Well, I did play in the days when the ball was a distraction from activities on the pitch, shall we say, in some of the games I played, and I refereed until the referees all got smaller and faster, and I refereed Nant Caredig once. Just once, I remember that one. I guess Mynydd Bach many years ago in Swansea. So a little bit of a background there. But what stopped me from really becoming a good rugby player was lack of talent, fitness and commitment, just those things. Otherwise I'd have been an international. Okay, what is leadership? How is it relevant to sport? Leadership is relevant in whatever field, okay? Leadership is, the principles of leadership are the same whether it's sport, whether it's politics, whether it's in business, same kind of thing. So what are we talking about when we talk about leadership? The first thing to do is, what are your goals? Establish what your goals are. What are you trying to do? What's your aim? So if you're on a rugby pitch, your aim is to win the game. Yeah. How do you, what you've got to establish first. If you're in politics, your aim is to deliver. You know, you've made promises in an election. How do you then go on and deliver on the promises that you've made? So first thing to do is establish, what am I there to do? What's my goal? Secondly, obviously, how do I get there? How do I get there? Once you've established what you want to do, you've got to chart the course to make sure that you can get to the point you want to be. And you do that by bringing people with you. There's no point being a leader if you run onto the pitch and there's no one behind you. You've got to make sure there are people there to support you. And there are two ways which you can do that. Persuade people. Convince them that what you're trying to do is the right thing to do, and they will come with you. They'll support you. They'll back you. They'll have your back. So persuasion, convincing people that you've got the right way forward. Secondly, example. You can't hide. Whether it's on a rugby pitch or any other area of sport, leaders have got to be up front. You can't put other people up in front of you. You can't hide when things get tough. You've got to front up. And that's what leadership is about. That's why it's tough. It's not meant to be easy. You're not meant to coast if you're a leader. And those are the things to consider when you're thinking about leadership, okay? There's another point that I want to make at this stage as well, because I know there was a question that I'm going to put on and on and on, as I said I would. Leaders are not afraid to take advice. The worst type of people are those who don't listen to others, who think it's a sign of weakness, actually. Think it's a sign of weakness, because you know, if you listen to other people, or if you change your mind because of advice you've received, that's a sign of weakness. That's not a sign of weakness. Okay? Weakness is when you think you can do it all yourself without listening to the advice of people who've been there before, perhaps senior players in the team. The advice of people who've got your best interest in heart, so you've got to make sure you trust the people who give you advice. There is nothing weak about listening, and there's nothing weak about coming to the right conclusion and working out the right way forward, having listened to people. I say, I've seen it time and time again in politics, where you see people who think they've got all the best ideas, they've got the great way forward, and the reality is they're not taking people with them because they're not listening to what people actually want. It's a bit like standing for election without talking to a single soul, saying, I've got all the ideas, I know the best way forward, and I'm not going to listen to any of the voters because none of them are relevant. Okay? The same is true. Listen to the senior people around you, listen to the people who've been there before, and that'll make you a better leader.
The both sides of leadership that you talk about, Dan, the persuading people to come with you, but also sometimes having to take charge and lead by that example. I mean, you've played with lots of different cabinet members and team members. They all vary. These boys will and girls will play with different team members. So does the style vary according to the team that you're a part of or the situation that you're in? When do you choose which style?
You've got to manage your team and you've got to understand the individuals. That's the key to it. You know, what you got to remember is that when you're in government, you've got a fair number of people who want your job at some point. So the key is to keep them at bay for long enough and to give them the impression that there'll come a time when they have a chance. That's what creates loyalty, okay? But you have to get to know the people in your team. There are some people who respond, frankly, if I can put it frankly, to a ball of it. There are other people who don't. They will absolutely hate you for it. There are other people who you need to sit down with and you need to talk them gently to get the best out of them. And there are other people for whom that doesn't work. And the only way, and you've got to tailor your approach to each person according to what you know about them. So get to know the people in your team. The best leaders look at their team and they say, I know what these people are like. I know what they respond to. I know what their difficulties are. I know sport is played up here. And if somebody is in a position where they've got problems at home, where they've just lost somebody close to them, we've seen now with Conor Roberts and with Nico Williams, a good leader sits down with them and says, how are you doing? You know, how can we help you? How can we support you? And that's what, not ignoring them, not shouting at them, that's the way you deal with people. You know, when I was in school, PE teachers were close to being sergeant majors, right, in the army. It didn't work out that way. It was all about do this, do that, run on that pitch now. When I blow this whistle, get down the mud and do 10 press-ups. That's what it was. That's not the way things are now. You know, so there's much more psychology involved, not just in life, but in sport. And to get the best out of people as a leader, you've got to know the people around you.
And you've alluded already to somebody always at your heels, sniping at your heels in politics, wanting that job that you've got. It's exactly the same on a rugby pitch, isn't it? Whether it's in the present team that somebody is playing in, or whether they're moving up to the Mynydd Mawr district or a region or whatever, somebody is vying for that same position. What's your advice on managing that situation?
It's all about performance. Okay. One of the things that's important is never big yourself up. Never go on Twitter and say, look how good I am. Never go on Twitter and say, I should be in the team, not that person there. That's arrogance. That's arrogance, okay? Do your talking out there. Do your talking on the pitch. Do your talking on the stage. Do your talking if you're a politician on TV. That's where you do your talking, okay? You don't big yourself up. Let other people big you up. If other people want to say, this person's great, let them do it, but don't do it yourself, okay? That's really, really important. But you also have to, and what I did was everybody knew pretty much that I'd set a limit on how long I'd be in the job for, okay? And oddly enough, in sport, you get to an age, you can't play anymore, right? Your body won't let you. It doesn't work that way in politics. You know, I could go back into politics if I was mad enough to do it, but I could do it because, you know, it's not as if I physically can't do it. And everybody understands that everybody has a point in time where they can no longer carry on, okay? People will stay loyal to you until you get to the point when you can no longer carry on. In politics, you set yourself a date. First thing I did when I became First Minister in 2009 was say, I'll do this for 10 years, and then I did 9. Because I knew if I did another year, I'd just be doing it just to get to 10 years. There was no way, and you get to the point where the stuff you've done over and over again just starts to bore you. And once that happens, it's time to move on. And so you can say to people, come with me, right? This is the way forward. This is what I want to do. In politics, come with me because we win elections. If we lose an election, that's it. You underperform, you go. And there'll come a point when you get the chance. And that's important. Say in sport, it happens naturally as people retire because their bodies, that's it, you've had enough. In politics, it's about giving people the impression you're not going to be there forever and a day. And saying there'll come a point when you get a chance. In the meantime, come with me and give me the support that I need.
It was a question that I had for later on.
I know, it's...
But Alan Wynne Jones then, there are some would say that he's totally mistimed it, not left at the top. Is that a strategy for managing, set the goal from the beginning?
Yeah, but it's difficult, isn't it? I mean, in politics...
Barry John retired at his prime.
He was 27 when he
retired.
Right at
his prime.
Yeah, and I don't think...
You can't...
I don't think... I think that comes. It's a hard one, right? And in this perspective, politics and sport are different. Okay, in politics, you can set yourself a time to go. Either people kick you out in an election, or your own party kicks you out, or if you have, or you got an election. I was lucky enough to have this, where halfway through a term, you say, right, I'm going to go now. Okay, that's my decision. That's it. And then you've gone up the top. You haven't gone up because you've lost. I think it's hard in sport because it's very difficult to say to a top class player, you know, really, you should retire now. It's really, really hard, and someone's done that for so long. And how many players have we seen over the years when they've been at the top of their game, and the following year, they're nowhere close to it. You know, the body is a funny thing. Sometimes it's injury that does it, you know, where players get injured over and over and over again, and sometimes a player will be fine one year, and the following year, the legs are gone. There's no way to know that. So it's a tough one. You know, it's easy to say, I suppose, well, Alan Wynn, you should have gone last year. But I've no doubt Alan Wynn at the time thought, no, I can go on for another year. My legs seem fine. And then for a lot of players, just their body intervenes and says, that's it now, well enough. And that happens, there's not much you can do about it. So I'm always reluctant to criticise people, especially in the world of sport, if people say, oh, they've gone on long enough, because it's quite hard to predict for any individual at which point you know you can no longer perform at the same level.
You mentioned the word injuries there then. We'll talk about adversities during careers maybe. That's one thing professional sports people have to consider. You've had adversities during your career. I remember you leading throughout foot and mouth when you were agriculture minister. That was a pretty tough testing time. Is there a formula when you come across an adversity, what do we do?
Whatever you do, more than anything else, don't listen to social media. Don't listen to Twitter. Twitter's an echo chamber, okay? And make social media your servant, not the other way around. How many young, I've got both my, I say kids, they're in their 20s now. It's not Twitter, they're not on Twitter particularly, but it's Instagram, Facebook, you know, TikTok, all stuff that I'm not on. And I say, why, you know, you spend all your time. So I'm pumped, you know, all your time out on the phone. It's their life. For me, they are slaves to social media. Right? No one cares what you're going to say, particularly, unless it's something profound. And I stay off it. I don't tweet every single day, or five or six times a day. I'll tweet something. You know, if I feel I've got something to say, then I'll tweet it. Facebook, you won't get onto my Facebook page unless I know you. I'm not interested in broadcasting to the world anymore. That's not the way it is. So social media is not reflective of society as a whole. Right? It just isn't. It may seem that way sort of the time, and it can grind people down. If you're having a bad game, or if you're going through a difficult time in politics, if you go to social media, you just want to resign there and then. Because that's all you get is idiots, trolls, people who are too chicken to actually put their own views forward and their own name. It's coming out and offering all manner of abuse. Usually the ones who use capital letters, and gas bell, right? Those are the worst ones. And ignore it. Ignore it, okay? Just ignore social media. Listen to the people around you who will give you sound advice, who will say to you, ignore all that, right? This is the way forward, follow it, okay? What you're doing is you're on the right track, ignore all the idiots on social media. And that's the way to do it. If you're in a crisis situation, I've had more than foot and mouth, I had a problem at the end of my, you know, real difficulty at the end of my time as First Minister. You can never know whether what you're doing is absolutely right. You've got a crystal ball, you don't know what's gonna happen in the future. All you can do is say to yourself, I think this is the right way forward. If you're not convinced that what you're doing is right, it's stuffed. It means it's not the right way forward. Because if you can't justify to yourself what you're doing, then it's not the right way forward for you. Okay? So you've got to ignore all the voices, because for tongue, foot and mouth, there was no social media. You know, it was letters to the Western Mail, represented Twitter. And even then we had some mad stuff.